only are gonna deal with this northeast, Roman numeral one, plus plus quadrant. Because this constraint and this constraint is what makes those quadrants. So which one of these is C4 and which one of these is C5? If this is the x1 and this is the x2, which is the convention.
No, that's true.
Now why? If I'm out here at a million x1, and I go down 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0, what is preventing x1 from going negative? It's this x. Mm-hmm. Likewise, if I'm at a million x2 and I come down 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0, it's this x. So it's bad. It's exactly opposite what everybody predicts, and I do that every time, and everybody gets it wrong, and that's okay. Once you kind of understand this one time, you realize, oh, it's the opposite of what we think it should be. And the way to prove it, again, kind of like the other part of the class, don't believe me, you can prove it to yourself. Put a million in there, and then go 10, and then 9, 8, 7. Oh, yeah, that is what's making x1 not go negative, and this is what's making x2 not negative. Okay? So, again, I labeled everything so I can label the picture. So we've just plotted these two constraints. So five constraints to solve the problem. We got two of them already on there. It's just the axis. So the next easiest one is C3 because it's just x1 has got to be less than equal to 40. So if I come out here about, oh, that looks like 40 to me, and I make a line, and this point right here on this line is 40 comma 0 right there. That's the constraint. It's basically saying I took the infinite square of going to plus infinity, all the way out here, right? I keep going all the way out. I get the plus infinity on x2 and plus infinity on x1. I just stopped the plus infinity on x1 and said, you can't be greater than 40. So because of the less than or equal to, that means that C3 has got to be this way. It's an infinite rectangle of width 40 that goes to infinity this way right now. And if I stop, I draw my blue picture, I'm going to draw it in here, man, I got blue. I'm going to draw it in and show you where the feasible region is. If I didn't have C1 and C2, I would just have an infinite rectangle right there. Which, if you ran in a linear program, would come back with an error message called unbounded. Because it's saying I can have an infinite problem. I'd make 40 soldiers and an infinite number of trains, and I'd be in infinity air. Okay? But I've got these other two. The next easiest one is C2, because the coefficients are both 1 and 1. So again, algebra 2, we've got to think way back to when we did that. My instructor in high school for algebra 2 was a lady named Miss Freeman, who did not like me at all. Who would be amazed I'm standing here doing this. But she taught me the thumb method. The thumb method is, if I want to know where this equation crosses in this picture down here, I cover up x2 and solve for x1. And so where is it going to cross on the x1 axis? 80 comma 0. So I go out here, this looks about right. 80 comma 0. Okay. And then I use my thumb method again on x1. Where is it going to cross the x2 axis? 80. So here it's going to be 0, 80. And so then I strike a line between those two, like that. And now I got to think a minute. Because now I've bisected the infinite rectangle. Is the feasible region above that green line, or is the feasible region below that green line? And how do I know? The easiest way to remember is you plug into your equation the value of the origin, 0, 0. And so if I plug in 0, 0 into the equation right here is 1, 1, less than equal to 8. So if I plug in 0 times 1, plus 0 times 1, so now the left-hand side is zero. Everybody can see that? And then I ask myself the question, is it true that zero is less than or equal to 80?
Every day of the week.
So that means that an origin has got to be in the feasible region, so the arrows go this way. C2. And so now the infinite rectangle is become this four-sided shape. That's the feasible region, but we've got one more constraint to put on. Now this is 2x1 plus 1x2 is less than or equal to 100. So I use my thumb again. And so 2x1 is less than or equal to 100. Where does it cross the x1 axis? 50. So I come about, this was 80 and this is 40. This looks about 50. Okay? So that's 50 comma 0. And then I go back up here and I cover up x1, and then where does x2 cross? 100. So I got to go above here, it looks like right here. So this is 0, 100 up here. And now I cross this way. By that same logic, C1's got to be this way if you plug in the origin. And our feasible region then becomes this blue shape, including the line. Meaning any multiple of x1 and x2 that is either on those lines, five lines, or inside there, is a we would make profit. It's feasible. But just like before, it's not our goal just to be feasible. We want to maximize. Now the slope of the line. The slope of the line over here. That. So 3x1 plus 2x2 is equal to the big giant E, family of lines. So this is the isoprophic line family, where there's a whole bunch of lines that are the same slope. When you do the algebra here, what you end up with is you find that the slope of the line is equal to minus 3/2. I'm going to let you prove that to yourself by doing the algebra with this equation. It ends up that the slope of the line is minus 3/2. So that means if I go up 3 here and over 2 there, there's a line there, there's a line there, there's a line there, etc. There's a whole family of lines that's the slope minus 3/2, down 3 over 2. And so there's a line that goes through here, and a line that goes through here, and a line that goes through here, and a line that goes through here. And so there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 extreme points. Let's Roman numeral them. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Now, if you were as old as I was, and you walked around when you were in engineering school, and you had a protractor in your pocket, and you had a pencil holder, everybody can pick you out. Yeah, you're an engineer. Because I didn't go to Georgia Tech. I went to UT Knoxville. And we were a subset of the big school. And there were all kinds of majors. People, all kinds of majors in my hall. And you're like, yeah, there's the geeky engineer right there. Okay? You would have drawn this picture much more accurately. And we could have used the isoprophic line method to actually, with our protractor, find the optimal solution. We don't walk around in 2016 with protractors, and you can see that I drew this picture. Just yeah, that looks like 40 to me, and that's right. Because we're not ever going to do it that way. Okay, I showed you that to get you the visual, because there's going to be a visual when we talk about sensitivity after a while that visual is going to help with. Okay.